Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the vertebral column. The vertebral column is a series of bones called vertebrae, arranged vertically downwards from the cranium. Usually there are around 33 vertebrae, and this column is divided into regions. From the top, we have the cervical vertebrae, then the thoracic vertebrae, the lumbar vertebrae, sacral and coccygeal vertebrae. Usually there are 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic, and 5 lumbar. The 5 sacral vertebrae fuse during the course of life, later in life, to form a single sacrum, and 4 to 5 coccygeal vertebrae also fuse, forming the coccyx. Just like a lot of things in human anatomy, the number of vertebrae can vary. Sometimes part of the 5th lumbar vertebra might fuse with the sacrum, when it's said to be sacralized, sacralization of L5. Instead, if part of the 1st sacral vertebra stays separate, it's said to be lumbarized. It's always good to remember that anatomy varies. Let's mark up anterior and posterior for this column. Each region of the vertebral column curves in a different direction. The thoracic and sacral regions are convex posteriorly, while cervical and lumbar are convex anteriorly. These are curvatures. During fetal life, it's uniformly convex posteriorly. That's the 1st, and it gets retained in the thoracic and sacral regions, making them primary curvatures. During infancy, when that head gets held up, that creates a secondary curvature in the cervical vertebral region. Standing upright and walking leads to the lumbar curvature. So these two are secondary curvatures. These are the normal spinal curvatures. If the thoracic curvature is excessive, an increased posterior curvature, the term used is kyphosis. Similarly, if the lumbar curvature is excessive, an increased anterior curvature, it's called lordosis. This vertebral column literally forms the backbone of the body. Together with the skull and the thoracic cage, they form the axial skeleton. So it's very important for support and movement, which happens by joints between the vertebrae and by the muscles and ligaments that attach to the bones. But also, the vertebral column protects a very important structure, the spinal cord, which sits in the vertebral canal. The vertebrae are stacked one on top of the other. Each one has a vertebral foramen. Those foramina unite to form a vertebral canal. Now, all these vertebrae would have differences in their appearances. In the first 3 parts of the series, I have covered some of the different features of these vertebrae, but now we're going to be looking at the column as a whole. For that, we need a quick recap of the parts of a typical vertebra. This is looking at it from above, so this would be anterior and this would be posterior. It has a vertebral body anteriorly and a vertebral arch posteriorly. In between the two is a vertebral foramen. The arch and the body are united by pedicles. From the pedicles emerge 2 laminae. At the junction of those 2 laminae is the spinous process. There are 2 transverse processes, one on each side, and extending above and below are a pair of superior and a pair of inferior articular processes. You can see them better from the side, so these would be the articular processes. Joints are formed between bones, so between the vertebrae there are joints as well. Between the vertebral bodies and between the vertebral arches. These joints are how movements happen. Movements between the individual vertebrae is actually very small, but it aggregates over the whole column for big movements to happen. What are the movements? Let's assume this is a neutral spine. I'm drawing stick figures here and I couldn't figure out how to draw them in the anatomical position, so just focus on the spine and ignore everything else. Bending forwards would be flexion. Bending backwards would be extension. So returning to the midline from flexion would also be extension. Bending to the side, either side, is lateral flexion. And coming back to the midline from lateral flexion is lateral extension. And then there's rotation. Rotation doesn't actually happen in all parts of the vertebral column. How much of these movements are allowed depends on what region of the column we're looking at. For example, flexion and extension are restricted in the thoracic region, but it allows the most rotation, while the lumbar vertebrae restrict rotation, but they allow flexion and extension. It depends on different factors, like the angles between those articular facets, the fact that thoracic vertebrae have attached ribs, etc. But those movements all happen at the joints, and these joints are stabilized by ligaments. The vertebral column has joints between the bones forming the column, and joints that attach the column to other bones. There are intervertebral joints between the bodies of the vertebrae, and joints between the articular processes called the zygapophyseal joints or facet joints. At the top of the vertebral column are atlas and axis, which have special joints, the atlantoaxial and atlantooccipital joints. Thoracic level, the ribs form joints with the vertebrae, the costovertebral and the costotransverse joints. Lower down, the sacrum articulates with the ilium through the sacroiliac joints. These are all the important ones, but since we're looking at the vertebral column specifically in this video, these two I find are best learned with the thoracic cage and the pelvic cavity. And I have talked about atlas and axis and the joints between them in part 3 of this series. So now we'll just focus on these two. The intervertebral joints we'll look at first are between the vertebral bodies. They are secondary cartilaginous joints, or symphyses. These joints are important for weight bearing. Between the two vertebrae is a disc called the intervertebral disc. So it's like vertebra, disc. You can see how this is going to be adding to the height of the column. Around 20 to 25% of the height is supposed to come from these discs. Let's look at the disc from above. Each disc has two parts. In the center, there is the gelatinous nucleus pulposus, and around it are concentric layers of fibrocartilage called the annulus fibrosus. The angle of the fibers changes between the layers, and that fibrocartilage gives the disc strength and makes it a cushion and a shock absorber. The nucleus pulposus, if you want to tie in some embryology here, it's the remnant of the notochord from the embryo. It gives the disc flexibility and resilience. The disc can resist compression, and it's important for weight bearing, which is what this intervertebral joint does. The first two vertebrae don't have a disc between them. The rest do, all the way up to the disc between L5 and S1, which would be the last functional one. These joints are supported by ligaments, one in front and one behind, anterior and posterior, all along the vertebral column, so they are the longitudinal ligaments. The anterior longitudinal ligament extends from the sacrum along the vertebral bodies and the intervertebral disc up to the occipital bone. At the top of the column, there's a slight change between atlas and axis and atlas and the occipital bone. The uppermost parts of the anterior longitudinal ligament form the anterior atlantoaxial membrane between atlas and axis, and the anterior atlantooccipital membrane between atlas and the occipital bone. This ligament is in front. Its main job is to limit how much the vertebral column extends. It brings it back to midline. The rest of them are all on the posterior aspect, so they'll be working to limit the different forms of flexion. But this one, the anterior longitudinal ligament, limits extension. Posterior longitudinal ligament is on the posterior aspect in the vertebral canal. It's inside the canal, but I'm just going to draw it on the surface here. It gets attached to the intervertebral discs and also the posterior aspects of the vertebral bodies. It actually continues into foramen magnum as the tectorial membrane. Its job is to prevent too much flexion of the vertebral column and also prevents posterior herniation of this disc. So that's the intervertebral joint between the vertebral bodies with its disc and the supporting anterior and posterior longitudinal ligaments. Now what about the arch? Between the superior and inferior articular processes of the vertebrae are the zygapophyseal joints, also called facet joints. These are plain synovial joints, each with a thin joint capsule. The articular processes attach to each other at different angles, depending on which part of the vertebral column we're looking at. The shape and orientation of these processes is one thing that determines the type of movements that can happen at each region of the vertebral column. These joints are supported by accessory ligaments, which connect the different processes of the vertebral arch. There are ligaments between the laminae, between the spinous processes, and the transverse processes. Now we'll get a little schematic. We'll take a hemisection of this vertebra. We'll include the vertebral body, the spinous process, and the lamina between them. So we're just looking at one half of the vertebra from one side. The vertebral body, spinous process, and the lamina. This would be anterior, and this would be posterior. And one more vertebra below that. Now we add in the ligaments. We'll start with structures we already know. Between the bodies is the intervertebral disc with the nucleus pulposus. In front is the anterior longitudinal ligament. And behind the vertebral body is the posterior longitudinal ligament. Now we add in the accessory ligaments. The first one is the ligamentum flavum. Flava means yellow. This ligament is yellow from elastic fibers. It is a yellow elastic ligament, and it's between the laminae of the arches, from the one above to the one below. They meet and blend in the midline. What's its job? During flexion, it stops the laminae from separating too much. It's an elastic ligament that brings them back together. It also assists in the process of extension, bringing the body back to the anatomical position. Remember, these are all going to be ligaments on the posterior aspect, so their job is to restrict too much flexion from happening. At the junction of the laminae, there is a spinous process extending posteriorly. Between the spinous processes is the interspinous ligament. These ligaments connect adjacent spinous processes. But between the tips of the spinous processes is the supraspinous ligament. This goes from the sacrum up to the seventh cervical vertebra, C7. So we have the ligamentum flavum between the laminae, the interspinous ligament between the spinous processes, and the supraspinous ligament at the tips of the spinous processes. If we were to bring back that typical vertebra, this would be the ligamentum flavum, this would be the interspinous ligament, and this would be where the supraspinous ligament attaches. From C7 upwards, the supraspinous ligament continues as the nuchal ligament or the ligamentum nuchae, which is like a triangle. The base attaches to the external occipital protuberance and foramen magnum. The apex would be the tip of the spinous process of C7. And the deep part of the triangle attaches to the posterior tubercle of C1 because, remember, it doesn't have a spinous process. The rest of the cervical vertebrae do, so it attaches to the tips of all their spinous processes. This is on the back of the neck, so it supports the head. It resists too much flexion and helps bring it back to the anatomical position. The last set of ligaments are between the transverse processes. These are the intertransverse ligaments. So there are the zygapophyseal joints supported by accessory ligaments, the ligamentum flavum, the interspinous, the supraspinous, the nuchal ligament, and the intertransverse ligaments. And that's just some stuff about the bones, joints, and ligaments of the vertebral column. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.